You never know when your life will be shaken. Last year I lost
my job. Everything fell apart. All my life
I depended on my money and success. I had it all, but I felt
so alone when my husband died.
I've always relied on myself. Then somebody showed me
hope that could transform my life.
I'm not talking about religion. I'm talking about a
personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
And I was able to find it here.
How then will he know never heard.
Y'all will stand and let's join us in praising the Lord in song.
The cross before me, the world behind, turn it back, raise a banner high. It's not for me, it's all for you. Let the heavens shake and lift the sky. Let the people clap their hands and cry. It's not for us, it's all for you. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us.
into Jesus for the cleansing power.
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace's hour?
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood?
Stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me and stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood.
What can wash away our sins? What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for how you've loved us and given us that capacity to love one another. Father, we pray that because we love those of our community, we go out. Be with each and every person who has made the effort today to prepare to go out and share that love with those in our community. Father, we pray that you'd prepare the hearts and the homes of the doors that will be knocked on today, that they will be receptive to the information that will be shared with them. Father, we pray for opportunities to share the entire gospel of Jesus Christ with people at their door today or in their living room, in the nursing homes, all of the different areas at the flea market, that there will be opportunities today to introduce our community to the love that you've given to us. Father, bless our time of worship now as we give back to you just a portion of that which you've given to us so graciously and so abundantly. We pray that you would take that and multiply it across this world, so that others here and in other countries around our world can be introduced to the love of Jesus Christ. We ask these things in his powerful name. We thank you for his ability to save us from our sins. Thank you for sending him to take our sins upon him and give us a way of eternal life. Amen.
Morning Star. Savior, you are friend. You are all I'll ever need, Lord, you are. You are glory, hallelujah. You are hope of peace on earth. You are Alpha and Omega, you are. You are the Lord on high. You are the way, the truth, the life. You are the Word made flesh. You are the bright morning star. You are glory, hallelujah. You are hope of peace on earth. You are Alpha and Omega. You are. You are the Lord on high. You are the way, the truth, the life. You are the Word made flesh. You are the bright morning star. You are my God and my King. You are the words that I sing. You are the reason I make this offering. You are my God and my King. You are the words that I sing. You are the reason I make this offering. You are the bright morning star. You are.
You never know when your life will be shaken. Last year I lost
my job. Everything fell apart. All my life
I depended on my money and success. I had it all, but I felt
so alone when my husband died.
I've always relied on myself. Then somebody showed me
hope that could transform my life.
I'm not talking about religion. I'm talking about a
personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
And I was able to find it here.
Thank you, Celebration Choir. It is a beautiful day to be at Kingsland Baptist Church, isn't it? You feel that way today? Amen. We at Kingsland are throwing a block party for our whole community, and all of you are invited. Easter weekend, on Saturday, that's April 3rd, we have a block party at Ironbridge Sports Park on Route 10. Ironbridge Sports Park, had a hard time spitting that out. Right there on Route 10 with the go-karts and the putt-putt and all that stuff. Well, we are opening our arms to the community. And we're reaching everybody with our block party. We'll have a climbing wall, food, Easter egg hunt. The radio station will be there. It's going to be a great, great day on April 3rd. And you'll notice when you came in today and you got your little bulletin that there is an invitation, a flyer to our block party inside your bulletin. And we want you to take that and pray about somebody special and give it to them. They're all over the church. They're in every classroom. They're out in the foyer. You can get more flyers. And also you'll notice, and maybe you noticed out on our sign here at Kingsland, the sign, we have our Find It Here banner up. Maybe you've seen the commercials. Has anybody seen the Find It Here commercial yet? Yeah. We're partnering with 45,000 plus sister Southern Baptist churches to provide this Find It Here weekend all over America, but right here at Kingsland. And this is a wonderful, wonderful tool that you can use. You may want to hand this out with the flyer to show somebody God's plan of salvation. Find it here, and when you look inside, you'll see you find it here at the cross. I hope that you'll take advantage of those tools. I've titled my message today, Find It Here. Find it here. Turn over to Matthew chapter 7, or find Matthew chapter 7. How about that? And we'll study a little bit of what Jesus had to say on his Sermon on the Mount. I'm sure you've heard of the Sermon on the Mount. I believe that the Sermon on the Mount shows us where to find it, how to find it, Maybe you've come to church today, and there's a lot of guests here. Thank you for being here with us. Maybe someone put one of these Find It Here brochures on your door, and that's why you're here today. Thank you for being with us here at Kingsland. What are you looking for today, church member, senior citizen, young person, adult? What are you looking for today? What are you seeking? I think most people, just like the little back of the little brochure, most people are seeking for hope and purpose and peace in life. And the only way to find that is through a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's the only way. Are you there in Matthew chapter 7? Jesus himself shows us how we can find it and where to find it. Look at verse number 7. These are some of the most wonderful and terrifying verses in all of Scripture. These are some of the most uplifting and heartwarming and comforting verses in all of Scripture, and some of the most horrific verses in all of Scripture. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. And he who seeks, say it out loud with me, finds. Find it here. To him who knocks, it will be opened. For what man is there among you who has, if his son asks for bread, he'll give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who seek him? Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are, say that word out loud with me, there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. Beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Of course not. Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. And some of the most horrifying verses in all of Scripture right here. Look at this. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me for just a moment? I want to pray. I want you to pray. There's a seriousness to this moment. You may be looking for something that today you're going to find it. You may have things in your life right now that are very, very, very troubling. I can tell you I am very troubled today, on the Lord's day. In my heart, I'm troubled. Very little to do with my message, but I'm very troubled about the state of our country and our government. I feel led right now to pray about it. If you don't think we have problems, you need to wake up. If you don't think America is in big, big trouble, you need to open your eyes. We need to pray for our country today. There's a lot I'd like to say. This isn't a political talk. But our country needs prayer right now. When the people of this land think that they can get something for free or that someone else is responsible to take care of them, and when that becomes the majority thought, we're in big, big trouble. So I just want to tell you personally, and I'm sure a lot of you share my heartache. I'm worried about America. I'm worried about the church. I'm worried about a lot of our families that are falling apart. We're supposed to be salt and light in this world. Even in the church, our families, statistically, they say families in the church and marriages fail in the church as much as they do in the rest of culture. What a disgrace. I believe there's a generation of people who are seeking for something. They didn't find it in the drugs, they didn't find it in the alcohol, or the lifestyle, or the whatever. They've got the home they always wanted, they've got the car they always wanted, they've got a lot of what they always wanted, but they're still miserable. And they need to find something. Something this passage lays out. So Lord Jesus, we ask that you would intervene. Holy Spirit of God, I pray that you would move in my life through this message. I pray that my words would be your words. Lord, I pray for our people. Pray for our families, some of which are struggling for a variety of reasons. Lord, I pray for that one who's hearing this message who is just genuinely lost, and they need to be found. They need to find something. They need to find you. Lord, I pray for America. I pray for our president, for our senators, our congressmen and women, for our leaders, regardless of party, regardless of political philosophy. Lord, I pray that you would help those who lead us to lead in the right direction. I pray that you'd give them great wisdom to make wise decisions, not foolish ones, to lead our country in the right direction, not the wrong way. Lord, as we just read, the path to destruction is very, very wide, but the path to eternal life is very narrow. Lord, help us to get back on the narrow path as people, as a church, as a nation. Pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. The only way you're going to find hope, the only way you're going to find genuine peace, the only way you're going to find purpose in life, true life, eternal life, is through a relationship with Jesus Christ. Please, if you have that relationship, do not tune me out. This is for you too. This is for all of us. You may have a relationship with Christ, you may not. This passage has something to say for each and every one of us. I want to point out three places to go to find what matters most. If you're looking for what matters absolutely most, here it is, right here in this text. First of all, find the love of the Father. Find the love of the Father. Now, I can tell you, I'm 36 years old, and I have three children, 8, 6, and 3. And there's still days that I wake up and forget, oh, yeah, I'm a father. How can that be? How did I wake up and all of a sudden I've got these children and a house and payments? What happened? Well, it happens. I love my kids. I look at my dad, a good man. Yeah, I'm a flawed man. My father was a flawed man, not a perfect man. But boy, did he love his kids. He just loved his kids. Thank you for Lucas bringing up the Redskins. My father in 1988 took me to a Redskins game. First game I ever went to. And the last one for a very long time. Until we moved back up here to Richmond, my wife and I. But man, it was like a religious experience. You know, it was awesome. It's like a dream come true. He loved me. He sacrificed to make that happen. Worked hard every day. Real hard. From before I woke up to usually before I went to bed, he was at work, providing for his family, doing what he could, took us to church, taught us to love Jesus. As good a man as my dad is and was, and he's still alive, but you know, my father loved me. He was a good example. Some of you did not have a good example. Your father was not a good example of God's love. Either way, you can be assured that the God of the universe, our Heavenly Father, loves you infinitely, so much better than even my dad did. This morning when I went to wake up my little girl and my baby boy, it was just a precious experience because they usually come in to me. But today, for some reason, they overslept. I got to eat and read the Bible and have all kinds of time with just me and Jesus. Elizabeth and John were gone. But I finally had to go up there and wake them up to go to church. And I just got there in their bed and I looked down on them, looked at their pretty little faces before they could start talking and asking for stuff. And they were, and they were angelic, you know. I just kissed them, rubbed their head and woke them up. And got them ready for church. It was awesome. I love them so much. But the love I have for my kids, the love you have for your kids, the love your dad had for you, or maybe did not have for you. Some of us have different experiences there, don't we? It pales in comparison to the love of God Almighty, our Father, how much He loves you, how much He loves me. Look at verse 11. How much more will your Father who is in heaven give you good things? Isn't that awesome? That's what God Almighty wants to do for you. He wants to give you good things. He loves you infinitely, and therefore He provides you with everything you need. And everything you need, here's what that translates it into. Everything He wants for you. That's what you need. Whatever He wants for you. Everyone desires to find and receive the love of their Father. Everyone. Not everybody gets it. Some of us have been hurt. Your picture of what a father is has been cracked and damaged. I understand. Sometimes we're disappointed by our daddies. But the love of our Heavenly Father never, ever, ever disappoints. Many adopted children, at some point, no matter how awesome their adopted mom and dad are, many of them go to they want to find their biological parents. Sometimes they're disappointed, sometimes they're not. But it's a natural desire to know your dad, your mom. God put that within the heart of every single person so that we would have a desire to know Him intimately. And you know what else? I look back to my dad. You know some of the funnest times I have with my dad? It was just going to work with him. I loved going to work with my dad. I loved being around him. I loved talking to him. I loved getting his van and driving places. To this day, I love doing that. That's the relationship God Almighty wants with you as a father with His child. And so many times I think we're so keyed up worrying about, oh man, I did this wrong. He's going to smush me. No, He's not. He loves you. He'll discipline you just like you discipline your children. Unpleasant sometimes, right? Yeah. But He loves you. And He wants to spend time with you. And He wants you to get involved in His work. If you love your father, you're going to want to get involved in what is important to Him. Look at verse 7. With that in mind, we can ask, we can seek, we can knock, knowing that God hears our prayers. And two times it says find. You see that? Find it. Find it. We can find it right here. He loves His children. It gives us exactly what we need, what He deems best. He knows how to give good gifts to the ones He loves. And He gives generously, abundantly. He's a generous God. I want to encourage you this morning to receive the Father's love. Just receive your Father's love. He loves you. If you don't have a relationship with God yet, He wants to make you His child, to adopt you. If you do have a relationship with God, can you just for a moment put the cares of this world away? Forget the stuff that you want to do this afternoon or the bills you can't pay or whatever's going on or what you don't like about yourself or what you don't like about life. And just embrace and receive, or better yet, for some of us, we need to be reminded, to have that fire rekindled, to rediscover God's awesome love. He loves you that much. He loves you so much. All these songs we've been singing about the blood this morning, the blood of Jesus, that's how much He loved you. God Almighty sent His Son Jesus to die for you, to shed His blood. All you need to do is receive His love, to be born again. If you are born again, why are we not more receiving of His love? When did we forget that we needed that more than anything else in the world? His unconditional love. C.S. Lewis wrote this: on the whole, God's love for us is a much safer subject to think about than our love for Him. Isn't that true? Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we fail. Our Father's love is unconditional. Look at verse 12. Whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. The golden rule. You can't love others properly until you first receive the love of your Father. Psychologists will tell you, most of the people with psychological problems, marriage problems, all kinds of problems, it all goes back to their childhood. 99% of the time. They may not have had the love of a father. The entire law is fulfilled by us loving God and displaying our love for God and how we treat others. And for that to happen, first, you have to receive His love. Now, we're talking about hope and purpose and life and peace. Is there anything more powerful than the peace of just knowing your daddy's got it under control? He's in charge. He's got it under control. Peace is awesome. Peace is an inward tranquility that is the result of proper thinking, which in turn results in proper living. Webster's dictionary defines peace as freedom from war or a stopping of war, an undisturbed state of mind, absence of mental conflict. You see, when we experience God's peace, it totally changes how we think of ourselves, and then it changes how we relate to others. One reason some of us are so bickery and difficult to get along with, you don't have any peace in your heart. The love of Christ isn't ruling in your heart. You may not even have it to give. Ladies and gentlemen, we are born at war with God because of our sin. But Christ's sacrifice on the cross, His blood, made it possible for us to have peace with God, our Father, and then peace with everyone else. Real peace is simply an after effect of our relationship with Christ. If you don't have peace, if your mind won't slow down, if you can't sleep, if you're of a nervous wreck, maybe you need to look for the peace of God, the peace that passes understanding, and go back to a core fundamental here. Find the love of your Father. Rediscover the love of the Father. Make peace with your Heavenly Father and live in peace with others because of the peace you have in your heart. Find His love. Rediscover His love. He's not hiding. You know, that find it here sign is just as bright as day out there, isn't it? God is not hiding from you. His love is available to you. Why do we put it off? Why do we let ourselves fall in love with everything else? We set our affections on so many other things and we forget all we really need is the love of the Father. How to find what matters most? Find the love of the Father. Secondly, find salvation. Find salvation. On Wednesday night, we had the men's study. And believe me, you want to be a part of these studies. The ladies' study they're doing is awesome. The men's study is fantastic. Wednesday night was a great night. We turned the video off. It was wonderful teaching. But I just had men in the room share their salvation story. And what a blessing it was to hear. These men, some of them are tough and gruff kind of fellows. They wouldn't do this right now. They wouldn't do this if the women were around. But you know what? With just us, with just a handful of us there, they were willing to share how God intercepted them, got involved in their lives and changed them and saved their soul. And man, it really did me good to hear about that. I told my story of being a lot younger, but realizing my need for Christ, realizing I was lost. I needed a Savior. And Jesus Christ came into my heart and saved me, forgave me of my sin. Even when I was young, I knew I was a little sinner in need of salvation. Do we get too old for that? Do we get kind of sophisticated and think, I'm a good guy. I'm fine. I'm swimming along just fine. It's kind of like the lifeguard. When someone goes to drown, sometimes they might not just jump right in and get them while they're flailing and trying to save themselves. Sometimes they'll let them get a little of that energy out. Then they'll grab and they'll pull them out when the person has quit fighting to save themselves. Salvation. It's a wonderful thing. My wife will love me bringing this up. She went to the dentist the other day and brushed her teeth like crazy for like a half an hour before she's going to the dentist. I'm thinking, what's up with that? You're going to the dentist. I mean, when I'm going to the dentist, I don't brush for a week. I want to get my money's worth from that guy. But she's brushing and you ain't even get it because she wants her teeth as good as possible to go to see the dentist. Because you know good well he's going to put some juice in there, he's going to look in your, and there's going to be plaque. I don't care who you are. You're going to have some plaque. She probably did. She had a very good report from the dentist, actually. Glowing marks. But when you go to the dentist, the reason you go is because you got stuff in there that your brush isn't going to get out. In fact, my dentist told me, you need to quit brushing so hard. You're tearing up your gums because you brush so hard. Trying to make your teeth clean. Ladies and gentlemen, we have sin in our heart. We have stains in our heart. We have heart decay that only God can get out. Only He can cleanse that. Only He can scrape that out through the blood of Jesus. We need salvation. We need to be born again. We need to be saved. He can cleanse us. Look down at verse 13. These verses should make us shake in our seats, ladies and gentlemen. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way that leads to life, and there are few who find it. Ladies and gentlemen, if that doesn't get your attention, nothing will. I can scream, jump, dance, do a flip off the stage. If God's word doesn't get your attention, nothing will. Look at it again. Enter by the narrow gate. Now be reminded that Jesus said, I am the gate. I am the door. If any man enters by me, he'll be saved. John 10:9. John 10:10 says, the thief comes to kill, rob, and destroy. But I've come to give you life, and that more abundantly. That's Jesus. I'm the gate, he says. Jesus of himself, I am the gate. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction. What is that? What is that? That's eternal separation from God. That's completely missing the purpose for which you were born. That's hell, ladies and gentlemen. Hell. Talked about it in detail just a couple weeks ago with the rich man and Lazarus. The rich man died and went to eternal, everlasting, conscious punishment in hell. Judgment. It's separation from God. So we need to enter the narrow gate, because wide is the gate that leads to destruction. And there are many, many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way that leads to life, and there are few who find it. That verse terrifies me. I'll tell you, that verse motivates me for one more time to go ahead and put on my little Operation Chesterfield shirt and to go out. Now, this week's going to be a lot better than last week. Last week was rough. It was cold. I had a sweater on, a coat, and I was freezing. But we went out anyway. My partner had a t-shirt and didn't seem to care. Took care of business, no problem. But me and John were going as fast as we could, freezing. Today's going to be great. Today's going to be beautiful. There is no good excuse not to go out. Understanding that many, many are going down the wide gate. Had a chance to visit our guys over at the flea market this morning. They are passing out tracts and invitations and ministering to people. I got to share the gospel with a lady this morning. It was awesome. But I can tell you, and by the way, great crowd today. It's great to see everybody here. Parking lots are full. Pews are full. That's wonderful. Breaks my heart, though, to see thousands of cars parked at a flea market on the Lord's Day. Most of which are saying that garbage is more important than the Word of God and honoring God with my time on His day and worshiping Him. And I don't mean to cast judgment on them, but the Word of God does. And there's a wide, wide gate that goes to destruction. John MacArthur says this about this verse. Christ continually emphasized the difficulty of following Him. Salvation is by grace alone, but it is not easy. It calls for knowledge of the truth, repentance, submission to Christ as Lord, and willingness to obey His word and His will. That's a lie. The pathway to genuine salvation. Well, first of all, the pathway to hell is very wide, it's very diverse, it's very pluralistic. The pathway to genuine salvation is very narrow, and it is paved with repentance and faith. Repentance for our sins and faith in Christ who died for us. If you have your little things there, and I won't go through the whole deal for the sake of time, but you'll see inside of this Find It Here brochure that it has the cross, C-R-O-S-S. There's a place where important things in life can be found. Hope, purpose, peace, and life are found at the cross. And you can take this with anybody you want and say, hey, can I tell you where you can find hope and peace? I'll just let me read it with you. The C in cross is for Christ. The R is for a reason. The reason Christ died for us is our sin. The O is for outcome. The outcome of sin is death, eternal separation from God and hell. The S is for substitute. Jesus Christ was your substitute. And the last S is for salvation. Because Jesus is our substitute, He is the only way. He's the only one who can offer salvation. Would you like to repent? Would you believe in what He did for you on the cross? You'll be born again if you do. My little boy yesterday, driving around with David, I don't know why he kept saying this. I don't know if he wanted me to get him a present. I can't understand 99% of what the child's saying. And I'm driving down the road, I'm like, yeah, it's a good one, David. But I could understand him saying, I have two birthdays, Daddy. I want two birthdays. And I asked Elizabeth later, has he been talking about two birthdays? What's up with his two birthdays thing? Does he want more presents? Is he getting Christmas and birthday? I don't know what his problem was. But as he kept saying, I have two birthdays, Daddy, I started thinking to myself, you know what? That's my desire for his life, is that he will have two birthdays. Because he was born on December 14th, 2006. That December birthday is killing me. Six. Yeah. But I can't wait for the day when my little boy realizes he needs to be born again. Don't you understand? Being born once means you'll die twice. You'll die physically and you'll die and spend eternity in hell. You need to be born twice, physically and spiritually. That's why Jesus said you must be born again. Yeah, we'll die. Our physical bodies will get old and they'll die. But you'll spend eternity in heaven. Now look at verse 15 and then following. This is a warning. Beware of deceivers. Beware of deceivers. I had three stop by my house the other day when I wasn't there. Three deceivers stopped by to help us, to show us how similar their beliefs are to ours. They like to suck you in with the similarities and then educate you on what the Bible really says. Their definition, their interpretation of the Scripture. Listen, any person who does not teach that Jesus Christ of Nazareth was God in human flesh and our one and only Savior, that person is a deceiver. And any group that teaches that is deceiving you. Now, in case that's not specific enough, let's name names. If the Mormons come by your house, understand and be nice to them. Don't be ugly and throw things at them. Give them a gospel tract. Pray with them. Tell them Jesus loves you and Jesus is God, the only God. They're deceiving. The Latter-day Saints, the Muslims, Jehovah's Witnesses, the Pharisees. This verse is talking about the Pharisees. Very interesting. You see that? Go back to verse 15. Beware of the false prophets. Sometimes we can become Pharisees. Worry about everything on the outside, forgetting about what's going on in the inside, the internals. The Hindus, the Buddhists, the Baha'i, the New Age, the humanists, the secularists, the evolutionists, the atheists, the communists. I thank God that I can still talk bad about communists in America. Hopefully we'll be able to do that a little bit longer without getting thrown in jail. Even some preachers are deceivers. Some of the people you see on TV, they're deceiving you. On the radio, on the internet, heaven help us. Any group who adds to the Bible or redefines what the Bible teaches or says there's some other pathway to heaven other than Jesus, they're a deceiver. And by the way, the best way you can identify a counterfeit is to intimately know the original. That's the best way you can identify a counterfeit, is to know your Bible backwards and forwards. That's why you should be in this book every day of your life. And that's why you should sit down with your kids and read it. That's why you need to be in Bible study on Sunday mornings. All of us need to be in Bible study on Sunday morning, being intimately related to the Word of God. These Bible studies on Wednesday night do the same thing. They're awesome. And the more you get to know the original, man, when something comes up kind of stinky, that stinks. And you'll smell it a mile off. And you'll know it's deception coming your way. Verse 20, by your fruits you will know them. Just want to say one word about that. By your fruits, by their fruits you will know them. What fruit is your life producing today? Because it goes for us too. By your fruit, you will know you. What fruit is your life producing? Let's close. How to find what matters most? First of all, find the love of a father. Find salvation. And lastly, find a reason for living. If you've got that, you've got more than most people on this planet. To actually have a reason for living. I have a reason for living, ladies and gentlemen. And it's not about feeling good about myself. It's not about looking good. Not even about working hard or going to religious services. This church is not my reason for living. Making money, being sincere, accumulating things, acquiring possessions. No. Being entertained and amused. You would think that's a lot of people's reason for living. They can't wait for Friday night to be entertained and amused. And inebriated. To do whatever I want. To do my will. It's not my reason for living. Look at verse 21. Not everyone who says to me. Are you there in verse 21? Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father. Underline that. That is the disciples' purpose statement. He who does the will of my Father. Now before we do that, go back up there. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, I just told you a minute ago what a deceiver was. Jesus here, who is speaking? Jesus. And who is he? What authority is he taking? Lord. The one who will or will not allow people into heaven. Well, who is he saying he is? He's saying he's God. You don't have to believe that. You're not a computer. You're not programmed. You can choose to believe it or you can choose to reject it. But at least look at it rationally and intelligently and understand Jesus Christ is identifying himself as God Almighty. And not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father. You know, as God's children, our greatest honor is to get involved in the family business, to do the will of my Father. Our purpose, our reason for living is to model our lives after him, to serve him, to know him, to share him, to worship him. That's what it's all about. If your life does not reflect these purposes, you need to stop and take inventory. Examine yourselves to see whether you're in the faith. There will be many, it says many, ladies and gentlemen, many who will stand before God. And they're expecting to get a pat on the back and maybe they did good enough and it's going to be okay with between them and the man upstairs. They may refer to him as. But the truth is, what they're going to hear is, depart from me. I don't want for anybody to hear that. I don't want for you to hear that. I don't want for anybody I know to hear that. even complete strangers that I don't know. I don't want for them to ever have to hear that, because it's too late. And it's vital that each and every person under the sound of my voice do some self-examining today. According to this passage, the best way to know that if a person is in the family is that if that person is involved in the family business, he does the will of my Father. All of our lives can be evaluated by these three points, these simple questions. Have you found the love of your Father? Maybe today you need to reconnect. Maybe you need to get connected for the very first time. Are you saved? Do you have a reason for living? Do you have a purpose? Ladies and gentlemen, we have to make money. We have to put clothes on our backs. We have to live and provide our families. And there's so many things we have to do. But if we're not careful, that will become our main focus. And we'll forget that there is an eternity ahead of us. You know, we got a trophy today. And thank you, Lucas, for doing that. That was really nice. And I like it. But I can take you into my basement to a box where my mom and dad bent up all my trophies and put them in a box a long time ago and gave it to me. Get this junk out of our house. You deal with it, Pat. Here. So now I have a thing in my basement with all kinds of really good trophies. And it was a humbling lesson when I thought they were impressed with my trophies. I thought they had them stationed throughout the living room. No, they were happy to get rid of them. I thought, man, every trophy I'm ever going to acquire on this earth is just going to burn and melt and be left with nothing. The only thing that's ever going to matter about my life is what I did with Christ and for Christ. We are preparing for a block party on April 3rd. And three services on Easter Sunday. One at 6:30 down at the Sunrise service. And two here at Kingsland. One at 9:30 and the other at 11. Identical services. I hope that you'll come to one and serve in the other, because we're going to need your help. It could literally change the eternal destiny of people all over Chesterfield County. Am I naive for praying that? Maybe I am. We're going to go out and work hard this afternoon in our family business. And we're going to do it next Sunday. We're going to get word out all over this community that Kingsland is throwing a block party and offering Easter services. That will be amazing. A lot of hard work is being put into them. We are committed to making huge sacrifices with our time, our money, our energy, our very lives to help people in our community find what matters most. Because we're convinced that we can find it right here. Right here. Everybody needs hope. Everybody wants peace. Everyone hopes for eternal life. Everyone desires purpose in lives. And the only way to find these things is through a relationship with Christ. You may need to start one right now. Or you might need to focus on yours if you already have one. I don't know if you've ever, I'm sure all of us can relate to having a friend. Have you ever had a friend that you maybe you got along real good, but you had a falling out and you didn't talk for a while? Or maybe you just got moved. You just got away from that person. But then one day, maybe through Facebook, that Facebook's a real pain in the neck like that. It'll connect you with people that you maybe wish you had never ever heard from again. They can find you. Maybe you bumped into them on the street. But you had an opportunity to reignite an old friendship with someone who used to be important to you, but for whatever, maybe a fight, maybe a problem, maybe you just kind of wandered away, and it felt so good to have that sweet forgiveness. Just say, man, I'm really sorry about that. That was so petty. I wish that had. Would you forgive me for that? I'm sorry. Oh, yeah, of course I forgive you. Man, that was nothing. How you doing? How's your family? Doesn't it feel good to have reconciliation with somebody who you've kind of wandered away from? How much sweeter it is, Christian, today, to have reconciliation with your Heavenly Father who you've wandered away from. Would you pray with me to that end? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? And let's pray. We're going to bring this whole thing to a conclusion. Every Sunday at Kingsland, we offer an invitation. We invite you at this point to make a decision for Christ. Maybe you need to find salvation through a relationship with Christ today to have your sins forgiven. John 1, verse 12 says, as many as received him, to them and them alone, he gave the authority, the right, the power to become the sons of God. That's how you become a child of God, by inviting Christ into your life, receiving him, asking him to forgive you of your sins. In fact, I'm going to lead you in a prayer in just a moment and give you an opportunity to do that. Maybe you need to rediscover God's unconditional love for you today in a new and fresh way. Let God's love flow into every area of need, every area of hurt, every area of fear, of insecurity. Let God's love flow into every aspect of your life. Open up every door to your heart, every relationship. Seek out God's purpose for your life. Today, you may need to recommit to making God's purposes the priority of your life. And only you know how you're living your life. Of course, your spouse could give you some good information on that. Your kids are watching. They know whether or not he's been the priority. You may want to come to the altar this morning and just pray for your country, because we need it. Pray for your church. Recommit to making God's purposes the priority of your life. As we have our time of invitation, I hope that you will act. But those of you that are here that are hearing me right now, and you want a relationship with God, invite Christ into your life right now. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Ask Him to take full control of your life. I'm going to pray with you right now. And you can mouth these words, but it doesn't really mean a lot unless your heart is truly intentional. I'm going to invite Christ into your life right now. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart right now, I pray. Save my soul. Make me new. I give my life to you. If you meant that prayer and that's the attitude of your heart, I want to invite you to come down and spend some time at the altar. Pastor Derek will pray with you. I'll pray with you. Someone who cares for you will pray with you. One of our deacons will pray with you. If you want to spend some time alone at the altar dealing with these things, move. Don't wait. God in heaven, I pray that you would move powerfully now during our time of invitation. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing. Come as God leads you. Amen. Thank you so much for hanging in. We went a little long today. Thank you so much for hanging in with us. And God is working in a lot of people's hearts in a lot of different ways. And I praise Him for that. I'm very thankful for Robert and Deborah, my friends, the Elliots, who have come this morning, and they are requesting membership in our church. We're very happy about that. And Robert and Deborah are both saved. They've both been baptized, and they've been through our new members class. So we'll bring them before the church at our next business meeting and vote them into membership. If you wonder about those things at Kingsland, just know that we have a wonderful orientation class that Alan Chu teaches. And Alan's right there with the electric guitar. And you can get involved in that. Find out all you want to know about our church. And just come forward and request membership if God's leading in your heart to do that. Or come talk to me after church if you need more information about that. Ladies and gentlemen, we're a faith family. We look out for one another. We love one another. And we love this community. And I just thank God for the way you do that. I'm very thankful for you for doing that. Pastor Derek, come up and dismiss us today, please.
If you're visiting with us today, thank you so much for coming out today and worshiping with us and just getting to know us and our church family. Pastor Pat would actually like to meet you after the service. He'll be standing in the back. If you could just take a second and fill out the visitor slip that's in your bulletin so that he can get to know you a little better. And just hand that to him on your way out. Maybe spend a couple minutes talking to him. He would love to get to know you. We're about to go out and reach our community again this afternoon. After lunch, we're going to go out and we're going to canvass some different homes and minister at the nursing homes and to our first responders and things like that, just to show the community that we care. Yesterday, the Works Project team got a whole lot done. They actually showed up at Gates Elementary to do some work, and there was another community service team there who offered their support, and we got a lot of work done really fast. But we still need help with that. So if you're still looking for a ministry, Saturday at 9:30 at Gates Elementary, you can meet there and help us out with that. They really need your help if you own a power sander of some sort or a belt sander that could help us get some sanding done very quickly, or else we may be going a little longer than the rest of Operation Chesterfield. Also, there's a sign-up to help serve at the block party in the back. If you could just take some time to sign up for a specific area. This block party we do is for our community primarily and not for our members primarily. If you have kids, bring them, enjoy, but come with the reason that we're there, and that's to serve our community in a block party. So sign up to help out. You can sign up for that in the back. And let's pray and dismiss our service. Dear Lord, I thank you so much just for the fact that you have provided everything we need, Lord. And so many of us are looking in so many directions that we're forgetting to look up and we're forgetting to look to you to help us through the tough times in our lives, the tough economic times, the sin struggles that we have, Lord. And God, I thank you so much that you sent your Son to take our place and to die for us, Lord, that we can have life, that we can have everything that we need, that we can have a relationship with you. And I pray that if there's anyone in this room who doesn't have that, who is still looking, that they would find that they would talk to somebody, that they would be back here, that they would be able to hear your word presented clearly again, and that, Lord, that no one would leave this room today without finding what they're looking for and what they need most, which is you. In your name I pray. Amen.
You never know when your life will be shaken. Last year I lost
my job. Everything fell apart. All my life
I depended on my money and success. I had it all, but I felt
so alone when my husband died.
I've always relied on myself. Then somebody showed me
hope that could transform my life.
I'm not talking about religion. I'm talking about a
personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
And I was able to find it here.